Good morning. Can you all hear me, or is it a little bit too loud? Let me know. Okay. Good morning, and thank you all for joining our workshop at this quite early hour of the day. This is my colleague Lene, and my name is Elise, and we are both from the Danish anti-bullying program called Free of Bullying. In our workshop today, you will hear about the community-based view of bullying, the Free of Bullying program, and in the end, we will also talk about the important collaboration between childcare professionals and parents in bullying prevention. Free of Bullying was launched 14 years ago in Denmark, and is a collaboration between the Mary Foundation and Save the Children in Denmark. The Mary Foundation was established by Her Royal Highness Crown Princess Mary of Denmark in 2007. The underlying philosophy of the foundation is that everybody has a right to belong, and the aim of the foundation is to fight social isolation. I find the foundation to be quite special in the way that it does not just give out money to the projects that it is involved in, but it plays a very active role in all of the projects that it is involved in, which is why I'm also standing here with you today. I'm a project manager at the Mary Foundation, and I focus my work around Free of Bullying in and outside of Denmark's borders. Save the Children in Denmark is part of Save the Children International, which is the largest independent welfare organization for children in the world. Save the Children International fights for children's rights, and Save the Children International has a department in Denmark that cooperates with organizations in the part of the world where children need to be protected from war and other catastrophes. Save the Children Denmark also has a national department that work with children's rights to be protected from violence, from poverty, and from other violations, both in a digital and physical form. Lene, who is standing here with me today, is a project coordinator in the national department, and she focuses her work around bullying.
Yes.
Over to you. You have your own mic.
Yes, I do. Thank you, Elise. I would like this one. Thank you, and thanks for coming and to hear about this exciting program, we think, at least. I need to get away from that one, I think. Yeah. So Free of Bullying program is developed for children in the age 0 to 9 years old. So it's the youngest children we work with. What we do is that we give courses for the childcare professionals. So they are trained for this this new view on bullying, community-based view on bullying, and they buy these suitcases. The smallest suitcase is for the youngest children. It's for the nurseries and the daycares. The green one is for the preschools or kindergartens, so children in the ages of 3 to 6. And the blue one is for schools, the youngest children in schools, so it's for the 6 to 9 year old children and in the after-school programs. These suitcases, they consist of tools and methods and materials that childcare professionals, they incorporate into children's daily routines. And that could be when the childcare facility, the kindergarten receives new children, that they have a body, what's it called, a body program, so that the younger children, they have a body in an older child who will show the child around in the kindergarten and say, so here you can hang your coat and here's the playground and this is how we play with the toys, and maybe introduce some of the rules as well. If someone does something that you don't like, you say stop, and if it doesn't work, you call for an adult to help you. And in the scheduled activities, we have children's meetings in Free of Bullying, children democracy, so the children will meet and they will talk about what's going on in the kindergarten or in school. It's not for the youngest children though. And at these meetings, you can use a conversation board. We have in the suitcases, in the bigger suitcases, we have these conversation boards with a drawing of a situation, and the children, they will talk about this situation and On the back of the conversation boards, there will be some questions for the childcare professional to ask the children. So how is this boy feeling, and what does this girl think about it all, and what could he do, and what could she do, to talk to the children about what could be done in this situation and help them develop some strategies if they see something like this. And finally, to support the children's games. So, of course, the children, they will also play for themselves. And the childcare professional will be there supporting these games. So if a boy wants to be a part of a role play and they're playing family, in Denmark we call it mother, father and children, for example, and he will come and say, can I join? And they will say, well, all the roles are filled up, we haven't got room for you. The childcare professional can walk in and say, but what if the family were to go to a restaurant? Maybe we would need a pizza maker or a baker, or if they are going to the zoo, a zookeeper or something. So they can help broaden the games for more children to be involved. The program is widely spread in Denmark. We have 40% of the nurseries and daycares using the program. We have 60% of the kindergartens or preschools, and 45% of the schools using the program with the Buddy Bear. And we have other countries joining as well. We have Greenland, and we have Estonia, we have Iceland, the Faroe Islands, and Romania. So we also, as Elisa said, outside of the borders of Denmark. I would like to tell you a little bit about the competence center where we work. We are the competence center, to be honest. It's just us. It was based in Denmark, or established in Denmark in 2014. The reason we established it was that we had this the program, and other countries, they saw it and they wanted to use it as well. And we could see it's not a one box fits all solution. They will have to make a version that fits into the cultural aspect of the country and the context it's going to be used in. So they have to not only translate it, but also alternate it to fit into the culture that it's going to be used in. So we spread awareness about this community-based view on bullying. We have been working with this, the new definition, as you could say, from UNESCO for the last 14 years. And we would really like to continue spreading awareness of how to look at bullying. So that's why we're here today. We share knowledge about the importance of working with the children's communities from a very early age, because it's very important for the children's thriving and well-being. And then we assist these countries who want to work with free of bullying. We assist them all the way through the alternations and the translations, and help them through the process of developing a program that fits this country. And we take these four values as a guiding point. So it's tolerance, respect, care, and courage. Just shortly, because we have talked about it earlier in this conference, the community-based view on bullying is different from the first paradigm, as you already know. The first paradigm, represented by Olveus, he had a focus on parenting, that a bully would be a badly raised child, for example. He had focus on individuals, that a bully would be someone with a personality that's especially aggressive, no empathy, a lot of things wrong with the child. And he would have a focus on fixed position. There would be the bullies and there would be the victims. And these two are two different groups of children. And he would have a focus on finding the guilty person and in the end punishing him or her, or changing the behavior of him and her. This new paradigm, what we call the community-based view on bullying, is represented by EXPOS. So that's exploring bullying in schools, Dorte Marie Søndergaard, Helle Rabøl Hansen, among others. And they represent, they presented this view on bullying in 2011. So it has been with us the whole way through the program. And they focus on the group dynamics. They focus on bullying occurring in a group because of a group, not because of the individual children. They focus on the culture and the norms and the values of the group. And they focus on communities. They focus on not the individuals, of course, important, because if there has been something going on between some children in a group, of course it's important to look at who are these children and what we do to help them, but then step back and look at the community these children are a part of. And they say it's not fixed positions, it's floating positions, because one week you can have Elise bullying me and a month later maybe I have formed an alliance with some other children, now we're bullying Elise, or she shifts school and she's becoming the bullied in another context. So the positions may shift. And instead of finding the guilty ones, of course you do that, you find out Elise bullied Lene, we'll have to figure this situation out, but then we step back and we look at the community these girls are part of, the culture, and we have to create community again for all of these children. This is a short film explaining it.
From an outside perspective, it's easy to interpret bullying as a consequence of badly brought up children. It's also easy to assume that children are bullied because of something to do with their looks or personality. But in recent years, research has enlightened us about the actual mechanisms at work. And bullying is really not about the individual child. It's about the culture that exists within the groups of children themselves. We human beings have always needed each other, once just to survive, and now to feel safe and accepted. Social situations help shape who we are and define our identity. Being excluded from a group can therefore have devastating effects. Bullying ties in closely with our need to belong, to be part of a community. If we doubt whether we are accepted, whether we belong, we feel very uncomfortable. One way of easing the discomfort is to create another community, a new group, in which the ingredient that binds us together is bullying. In other words, bullying often sprouts from the fear of being the one left standing alone. In fragile and insecure communities, tolerance is low. Everyone keeps a watchful eye on everyone else. And the one who steps outside the box risks becoming the next victim. That's why many people become passive bystanders in the presence of bullying, despite recognizing the unfairness of what's happening. And then there are others who resort to bullying to avoid becoming a victim themselves. In other words, bullying isn't caused by individual children. Who will be the bully and who will be the victim is not always predictable. It depends on the children's group as a whole. The absolute best remedy against bullying is to support children to be more tolerant and help create positive children's communities. As an adult, you are an important guide and role model in children's social lives. Whether you are a parent, an educator, or someone who helps out with children's activities, you can make a big difference in preventing bullying if you proactively build and support the well-being and community spirit among children. And at the same time, encourage them all to be caring and to have the courage to stand up to exclusion and teasing when they witness it. And most importantly, never forget that bullying is the children's problem, but the adult's responsibility.
Yeah. She talked about values in the film, the lack of tolerance, for example, and free of bullying is based on four values. So we have tolerance, respect, care, and courage, as I mentioned before. And to us, tolerance is seeing the power of diversity and accepting others as they are. And that could be when a child says, look at that boy, he's got a pink lunchbox. And the childcare professional responding to that with a, yeah, lunchboxes are different, children are different, and that's good because then everyone can be who they are. Not making a big fuss about it, just stating the fact that the diversity is important and it's good that it's there. And respect is to be considerate and treat others kindly. So that's when we think about how we speak to others and how we speak about others. For example, care is to show interest, compassion, concern, and helpfulness to others. And children, they can do that as well. The youngest children, they can find the buddy bear and give it to someone who is sad about their father leaving in the morning, waving goodbye. A small child of 3 years old can find the buddy bear and come and comfort a buddy in the daycare. Of course, the adults are there as well. It's not a substitute for the adults in the institution. So, and courage is to dare to reach out to others and to say when your own or others' boundaries are crossed. And that also goes for a two-year-old child or one-year-old who can do this and show this is my boundary. I don't want it. And to teach the children that this means stop, both for the one doing this and for the one who gets a hand like this, you have to stop now, it's not nice for me. We have children putting words into this, into these values.
Tolerance, den kan jeg slet ikke. Det gør faktisk ikke noget, at alle er forskellige. Jeg har lært, at det er vigtigt, at alle er forskellige, for ellers vil det være sådan lidt kedeligt.
Forskelligt tøj og forskelligt hår og udseende.
Hvis nu Marius han kom fra et andet land, så skal jeg stadigvis tolerance for ham. Fordi så føler han det ligesom om, han er hjemme, når det er, han er i skole. Respekt, det er for eksempel ikke, hvis nu, at vi har vikar, så skal vi stadig opføre os ordentligt, selvom at det ikke er den, vi plejer at have.
Det er jo vigtigt at lytte efter.
Man skal ikke kaste med legetøjet, og man skal heller ikke behandle det dårligt, eller putte det i de forkerte kasser, når man er færdig med at lege.
Hvis nu, at Marlon han spørger mig, om vi skal lege, og jeg bare vender ryggen til og ikke siger noget, så viser man ikke respekt.
Omsorgsfuld. Hvis nu der er nogen, der falder og slår sig, så kan man hjælpe dem. Eller hvis der er nogen, der er lidt ked af noget, og de tror ikke rigtig at fortælle, så kan man snakke lidt med dem.
Hvis jeg siger noget, og for eksempel ikke, så siger jeg ja på en god måde, så kunne det virkelig være omsorgsfuldt, men det kunne også være på en måde lidt omsorgsrespektfuldt på en måde.
Hvis der nu var nogen, der drillede andre, så kunne man gå hen og sige stop til dem.
Og have mod, det handler om, at hvis nu der er nogen andre, der leger, men ikke rigtig ture og gå hen til at lege, så er man meget modig, hvis man bare går ind i lejen og spørger, om man må være med.
Hvis man nu ikke havde kendt dem i forvejen, så kunne det godt have været lidt svært.
Og der skal man være lidt modig, fordi hvis der ikke er nogen fra ens overgang, så må man jo spørge nogen fra første, altså de andre overgange, det vil han ikke have, at vi leger med.
Hvis man nu er generet over for nogen, man ikke har mødt i lang tid, eller nogen, man slet ikke kender, så kan man godt sige det. Så er man også modig.
Yeah, so even though the values are some grown-up words, the children, they can understand if you talk to them about them and explaining them and visualizing them for them. Yeah. I would like you to discuss something, and just to start, I would say parents are a very important role in Free of Bullying as well. we can't do anything to prevent bullying if they're not a part of the show, you can say. So we have some materials in the suitcase for the parents as well, to inform them at a parents' meeting, for example, and to involve them, for them to think about the values. What do they put into these words? Because they are only words if you don't think about what they mean to you, and think about how can they support the children's communities. So I would like you to discuss with the person sitting next to you, reading this. We pretend that you are the teacher. One of your students is feeling left out of the class. We could say it's an 8-year-old boy, excluded from the community. The parents of the student have told you that they are considering finding another school. You feel they are overreacting. What do you do? So discuss with your with the person sitting next to you, or turn around and find someone behind you. The time is running. I will stop you here. I will try and stop you here. The time is running. I would just like to have one example of what did you talk about. And Elise will give you the microphone because we're being filmed. Will someone say what they talked about? What is important in this collaboration? What is the first thing you do as a teacher if you think the parents are being a bit overreactive? What should be done? Or did you talk about something else important? Then we would also like to hear that.
Thank you. As a teacher, I would start being curious and ask the parent, what is he telling you that I haven't seen or he hasn't told me? And then I would try to find an occasion to go for a walk with the child, rather than sit in front of him. Say, your mother's saying, what do you have to say to that? So go for a walk. Can you help me fetch this in the basement or something? And then, try to ask. And then, of course, talk to my colleagues in the team, saying, hey, have you noticed anything? Can we? And then have a discussion with the rest of the team. What could we actually do? Is it fixed play groups and the 10 breaks for a while, or is it something else? But definitely take it seriously.
Good. I would like to, if you imagine, I draw a big number 6 here on the floor, and from my perspective, it's a number 6. And if Elise looked at it, what would she see from her perspective? A 9. So if we stand in our own perspective saying this is a number 6, and Elise will definitely say it's a number 9, we will get nowhere. So I will have to change perspectives, walking over here and say, whoa, it's a number 9 from here. So you see it differently. But we have to stay curious all the time, both to what the children are saying and what the parents are saying, because we're in this together and we have one common goal, and that's for the children to thrive and have a happy children's life. So instead of saying, I am right about this, you have to talk to each other. So that's all what we could do. Woo! We were both, sorry, we both needed to do that. So thank you for now.